Perhaps the outstanding quality of the music of Brahms is the wonderful sense of improvisation it conveys. Nothing is ever obvious in the structure of his compositions. One beautiful effect merges into another, as if it were ordained by nature to be that way. Such skillful concealment of art is, of course, art at its greatest. Brahms' Violin Concerto is one of the excellent examples of this seemingly improvised progression from beauty to beauty. Yet, if one listens closely, the main outlines of the work can be easily followed. Actually, Brahms keeps pretty much to the conventional form of all classical concerti. In a classical concerto, as opposed to a symphony or sonata, there is a particular problem of the exposition of the thematic material. For not only does the solo instrument have to announce those themes, but so does the orchestra. And the composer must use all his skill to balance these two announcements or expositions of the thematic material. Brahms, like other classical composers, follows this device of a double exposition. First, he has the orchestra alone state the main themes, which are, of course, skillfully bridged together. Then, the solo instrument, accompanied by the orchestra, repeats those themes, or variations upon them, and they are all so beautiful that we are delighted to rehear them. This double exposition takes up about one-third of the first movement. Let us look at those themes one after the other, first as stated by the orchestra, then repeated, somewhat altered, by the solo violin. There are four of them. The quiet opening theme is played in unison by the cellos, violas, and bassoons. Later, when the solo violin first plays this theme, it becomes enriched by luscious harmonies on the bassoons and an expressive running accompaniment in the violas. In the original orchestral statement, notice that the chord upon which that phrase ends is merely held for two measures before proceeding to the next phrase. This is the chord. And this is the second phrase. When the violin plays the phrase, notice how that chord is extended to 10 measures before proceeding to the next phrase. The violin outlines the chord and its neighboring harmonies with expressive arpeggios. Here is the chord, extended by a neighboring harmony, still here, further extended, and only now proceeding to the next phrase. This expansion of a simple theme to greater lengths is one of the devices Brahms uses to give that impression of improvisation which makes his music so beautiful. The second theme in the opening orchestral exposition is characterized by the bold jumps of an octave. Later, in the soloist's exposition, that theme becomes the accompaniment, while the solo instrument introduces a new figure. Listen to that theme with the bold octave jumps as it first appears in the basses under the solo line. Now that theme is in the fiddles of the orchestra. But still as an accompaniment. In the opening orchestral exposition, the third theme leads directly to the fourth theme. This is the third theme. It ends this way. Now there is a short bridge. This is the beginning of the fourth theme. A marvelous example of Brahms' inventive genius is what he does to that short bridge when the violin plays it. He interjects an entirely new and beautiful theme at this point, allowing more chance for the solo violin to sing. A truly inspirational parenthesis. This is the end of the third theme. But now, instead of the bridge, comes this inspired new theme. Only after this melodic parenthesis does Brahms allow the violin to restate the short bridge, which leads to the fourth theme. This is the bridge. And this is the beginning of the fourth theme. Another example of richness supplied by variation is in this fourth theme. In the orchestral exposition, it goes like this. At the end of the soloist's exposition, this material is almost literally transferred to the violin. However, the material is slightly expanded, by allowing the orchestral accompaniment to answer the solo voice in several places. Here the orchestra answers the soloist. Now the violin continues. To summarize and fix them in your mind, there are four main themes in the orchestral exposition. The first theme, the second theme, the third theme, and the fourth and concluding theme. Of these themes appear as well in the second exposition of the soloist, which also has one new theme of its own, that beautiful parenthesis. So much for the exposition, the first portion of every concerto. As usual, the development section of the movement follows. In this case, aside from ingenious development of all of the individual themes, there is one new element added. At one point, the orchestra states the third theme in minor. While the orchestra is playing that, the solo violin has the following counter melody. This figure is later amplified in the orchestra in this manner. As usual, a recapitulation of the main themes follows the development section. In Brahms' concerto, the recapitulation is almost literally like the soloist's original exposition, with one delightful exception. Just after the bridge, which follows the third theme, Brahms finds himself in a key where he apparently does not wish to remain. The parenthetical lyrical theme is commenced in this foreign key, but you will notice how skillfully he transfers the music back to the desired key. Here he is in the foreign key. now he corrects himself. As in most classical concerti, after the recapitulation, there is a point where the orchestra stops playing and the solo instrument plays a brilliant cadenza by itself. After the cadenza, the orchestra merely plays a short coda and the movement ends. However, in Brahms' concerto, the movement doesn't end so abruptly. Instead, a divinely peaceful mood is achieved at the end of the cadenza. This is created by the solo violin when it states the first theme, pianissimo, in the highest register. Notice what a sense of repose is achieved by allowing the violin to hold lazily onto one note of the phrase while the solo winds finish it. The movement ends with a brilliant pyrotechnical passage for the soloist. The second movement is one long song from beginning to end, a beautiful dialogue between the solo violin and solo wind instruments of the orchestra. The glorious opening theme is one of Brahms' longest themes and is stated first by the oboe, reinforced only by the other winds, with no support from the strings. Notice how the clarinet takes the melody away from the oboe. Now the oboe finishes the phrase. This is a short coda. After this, the solo violin repeats the theme with a beautiful effect of improvisation which marks the entire composition. It is fascinating to analyze in this case how Brahms gets that effect. Notice how the first two measures of the oboe theme become three measures when it is played by the violin. This is the way it sounded on the oboe. And this is the way it sounds on the violin. In the same way, four measures of the oboe become 8 measures in the violin. The oboe, and the violin. Rhapsodic middle section follows. Notice the subtle reference to the first theme in the winds. But before we realize it, we are back to the opening theme, which is presented this time as a dialogue between the violin and the solo oboe. The oboe starts the melody. Now the violin continues it. The oboe again, the haunting coda of the theme is now enhanced by new orchestration. You will recall that it sounded like this as it was played by the winds at the beginning of the movement. Now here it is at the end of the movement, where the solo violin is added to it. And the movement comes to a peaceful close. The last movement is a joyful rondo. Again, as in most everything Brahms does, its apparent simplicity covers a multitude of subtle musical inventions. The first theme could not sound simpler. An 8-measure gypsy-like phrase is announced by the soloist, after which it is repeated in the orchestra. Notice how the orchestra takes the theme away with a flourish by an upward scale. Now the soloist reasserts himself with a downward scale. Listen to the theme in the basses. There is a bridge between the first and second themes made up of fast scale figures going up and down. Those scale figures are far from mere ornamentation. When, at the end of the bridge, the second theme enters, listen carefully, and you will see that it is nothing more than a similar scale figure, only now much slower and more triumphant. This is the second theme. Often, Brahms makes thematic material out of figures which were originally accompaniments. Listen to this passage where the solo violin accompanies the original theme which is played by the orchestra. Now notice how those violin arpeggios gradually resolve themselves into a new theme here. Toward the end of the movement, there is an imposing orchestral climax. At this point, the violin begins a cadenza. As I mentioned in the first movement, a cadenza usually is played by the soloist alone to show off his technical skill, while the orchestra remains silent and only comes in at the end. However, in the cadenza of this movement, Brahms adds a novel effect by allowing the orchestra to accompany the soloist's pyrotechnics. The violin starts by itself. But very subtly, the orchestra comes in to reinforce it. First the strings, tentatively, then the oboes and horns, followed by the rest of the winds. The end of this accompanied cadenza is a delightful dialogue between the horns and timpani on one hand and the solo violin on the other. This leads to the coda, which is a reannouncement of the first theme in quick march time. There is one final example of how Brahms can take the simplest melodies and harmonies and make of them a work of infinite variety and beauty. Notice how, at the very end of the coda, he relaxes the triplet rhythm as if he were going to end softly, but then adds three imposing chords to bring this brilliant concerto to a triumphant close. So simple a device, and yet how noble it sounds. And now he starts the relaxation. And now the surprise ending.